Thank you. Our moderator for today's session is Dr. Bibhas Chaudhary, who is a writer, columnist, and an academician. Dr. Chaudhary is a professor in the Department of English, Guwahati University. He is the author of several books, which include English Social and Cultural History, Beyond Cartography, The Contemporary South Asian Novel in English, and Reading Postcolonial Theory. A fortnightly column on books and reading titled Loving Literature appears in the Assam Tribune newspaper. And apart from the role of an academician, he is also serving as the director in charge of Guwahati University Press and is currently working on a thematic introduction to modern Assamese literature. Welcome you, sir. The student volunteers kindly felicitate, sir. Without any further delay, I hand over today's session to our moderator. Sir.
On publishing in general, and the subject of publishing would extend to the changing circumstances of publishing and the possibilities of extending it beyond the conventions to which we are accustomed or familiar with. And since we have very experienced panelists today, we'll be looking at the questions of publishing and the future of publishing, the state of publishing, and with special reference to the region. I would like to take this forward by requesting our panelists to present their initial responses to the topic today, and as we move forward, then we can have exchanges and interact based on how the presentations are made. So I'll start with Priti Gill.
Because all this while I have been in a feminist press, right, from Kali for Women and then from Kobani. So in many ways it opened up the field, so to speak. So I just thought that I'll begin by just saying a few things which I've now been hearing about, because I talk to so many more publishers and I'm actually sitting on the other side of the table trying to sell a book to them, or an idea of a book to them, or an offer to them. And I keep hearing that it's a very, very difficult business. It is struggling, and the constant refrain is that there are fewer people who are reading, that there are fewer bookshops, things are closing down, there's only a certain kind of book that people want to be reading, young people don't read, and or if they read, then it's, you know, like Mr. Chetan Bhagat or other mythology, big stars in that world that you know the names of. So it's quite a difficult kind of field. I think it's difficult to publish the kind of book the Middle East, or whatever we call the Middle East, finds it increasingly difficult to get published. Those writers find it difficult because of the many changes that have come in as far as reading habits are concerned. The other thing is that everything that I say is basically based on chatter and on conjecture, and talking to people in publishing, talking to writers, and talking sometimes to booksellers. We really have very few facts to go on. We have very few databases, people who are doing research in this and putting out data. So it's you're actually just shooting in the dark half the time. Nielsen is one who does this, and so we had that first report which came out, which was pretty extensive and exhaustive, and which presented a lot of the data to do with India. And so now we get to hear that there are some 1600 to 1700 active publishers. Obviously, these are all people who've been filling in the data for Nielsen, and there may be many others. And so you get some idea of the kind of numbers that exist out there. And so that, let me just give you something. So we have 1600 to 1700, and we have 70,000 or so titles being published according to this research. We have print runs which have grown hugely, so you have up to 50,000 and over books being published. So I believe this new book by Chetan Bhagat, for example, which was just launched the other day, was the hugest number of pre-order sales in terms of numbers. So you have things like that happening, and on the other side you have the smaller independents, who are really small, and who may be doing just one or two books a year, but they are committed to, or they have a certain politics that they follow. And so we have a very varied kind of publishing scene in the country. We publish in many, many languages, 22, 24. The print runs vary, the kind of books that they pick up vary. So it's not at all a kind of homogenized level playing field at all. So, I mean, those were some of the things. Then when we start talking about the newer mediums, the electronic or the e-books, or now that you see them on these apps, what Juggernaut is trying to do, I think that a lot more was expected of the e-book than has actually come to pass. And that has been across the world. It's not just India. It's what they thought of, that it would take over about 80% or 90% of sales back in 2010 or so, when they, you know, the iPad and Kindle and Amazon launched all this, you know, its back-end and infrastructure and all of that. So they thought that they would garner that much of the market, but then I don't think that happened. And today we see that it's like a plateau almost. People that you talk to in publishing say that really, e-books, they didn't really take off the way they thought they would. And then there's, you know, Juggernaut, which is a totally new kind of avatar of what you're trying to do across different platforms and trying to present the book in many different ways. And so there is a certain technology involved. And does that work or does it not work? Everybody has an iPad or a smartphone or whatever. You see every young person and old person, you know, sort of tick-ticking away on their phones and reading and WhatsApp and whatever else. But has that translated actually into more readers? Have you expanded the market? Those are the kinds of questions I think that we need to look at when we talk about traditional versus electronic. Have we expanded the market, and are we actually bringing in more people to the reading habit? So I think with that,
ma'am, Geeta, ma'am, your views.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you for having me here. I think I heard Preeti. Oh, sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Great. Very happy to be here. I'm very happy to be back in Guwahati. I have a lot of friends over here, and so it's good to see a lot of familiar faces and to reconnect with everyone over here. So thank you for having me here. Publishing, I think, is a very huge field, and we have English publishing as part of that. I've always been, you know, puzzled when we say translation, we always mean translating into English. But so much translation happens between the languages. But somehow all that is sort of discounted. So the kind of publishing that I want to talk about is not in Nielsen, not in book data, not anywhere at all. But it's huge. If you really look at what's happening in Jharkhand, you look at what's happening in Uttarakhand, you look at what's happening in UP, you will find that, you know, lots and lots of happenings are there. Lots of books are being published. Whether we are publishing the kind of books for which we need to cut trees, because I'm very conscious of how many trees we are cutting to make our books. And sometimes the books are not worthy of the trees at all. I think you should have let the trees be, because the books that are coming out from the trees do not do justice to the trees and do not do justice to humankind, does not do justice to creating a kinder world. And I think we should all be creating a kinder, a more gentle world for ourselves. And I don't think our books today are doing that. But I really think when I look at what publishing can do, what the book does for us in our lives, I think it's enormous. It is this friend that we have, as we heard this morning, many, many friends. Today with Kindle, I can have a million friends just in my pocket. Who are these friends? What do I learn from them? That, I think, is a question that many of us do not ask. And because as adults we don't ask these questions, our children are not asking these questions. They are very important questions to ask. The second thing, when I look at the very vicarious lives that we lead today, we are not looking at our lives with our own eyes. We are not going out there into the forest. We are not going out there and seeing how people live. We think that we can live in this world which has been created, and that world will do for us. Does the book make it a better world? I would say yes, because it opens up so many different people's views. It opens up the imagination to so many other ways in which people live, the really good books, I mean. They add to the sum total of the knowledge that we have of the human predicament. And that is important. To lead a good life, you need to know how people are living their lives, the human predicament and the solutions that everyone comes up with. I think that's what the book gives. I lead one life. I know my life, and I know the problems in my life. And I think that this is without any solution. I'm despondent, I'm sunk in my own despair, and I think I cannot come out. What a book does is to give me different ways in which different people are finding ways out of their despair or out of impossible situations. Whether it comes as humor, I mean, when I read Jerry Pinto's, I think the kind of humor that, you know, makes life bearable, this impossible life that we are living, and it becomes bearable. And because I'm reading a book, it makes it possible for me to lead that life and to say, this too will pass. And I want to be able to say, this too will pass, and I think the book does that. So I put a lot of, I think, a value on a book. I think a book is very important. I think reading is very important. And I'll come to the ebook later because I think I've exhausted my time. Thank you.
Let's go.
Yeah, good afternoon, good morning, everyone. And good evening as well in advance. Thank you for having me here, especially in the presence of august persons like Preeti and Geeta, who have very nicely summed up already. Preeti has given a good summary of the publishing industry, and Geeta ma'am has spoken about the book in particular. I want to bring one point here. The book publishing industry is one of the nastiest, messiest, and most horrible industries in India, and probably the world. Because I'm a publisher, and we are not what you think we are. We may look quite somber and gentle with graying hair and everything, but we are in a mad world. Because number one, we have to deal, as a publisher, I also have to be a trader. And often I forget my editing because of my trading. Because we have to spend so much time in, like, you know, we have to offer long credit lines to the distributors, the booksellers, and then on top of that, the competition from every Tom, Dick, and Harry who becomes a publisher overnight, because it's a very easy line to make an entry. There is no government regulation, no organization. There's not even sales tax. So it's a medium for a lot of people to convert their black money into white. So in the process, we end up in this big quagmire, and I'm sorry, I'm not very good with big words. So which is the publishing industry, and often we lose touch with the reader directly. Regarding the data and all, you know, we have a serious dearth of data here in the publishing industry. Nielsen has made a tremendous effort, thanks to them, But I think there are 1,600 publishers that they have mentioned, we can easily triple it in India. Being from Assam, if you just walk into Pan Bazaar, you will find every bookshop is also a publisher. It's not that a book publisher becomes a bookseller. Now what is happening, a bookseller or a trader is becoming a publisher because they think it makes more money. And it does. But which books make the money? Low quality textbooks, all these solutions, model questions and answers that they're talking about. And for a general publisher like us, I was born into a publishing family. I salute Geeta and Preeti for choosing this line as a career. I think you did choose. So I had no option, but I'm not frustrated, although I'm pretty happy doing it. The thing is, you know, coming back to this point about a lot of publishers coming into the industry, when people say that reading habits have gone down, maybe they have to an extent, you know, because of all these games and these, you know, movies on mobiles and all this stuff. But then the population is increasing and people are reading. But the thing is, what are they reading? Are they reading Jerry Pinto or are they reading Chetan Bhagat? The quality of materials that publishers are providing today have also taken a nosedive. And that is what the readers are getting to read. School children here, they will read what is given to them. They don't know how to make a judgment. It is up to us. Anyway, I'll just sum it up with a little go between the traditional and the digital publishing. As a publisher, I take digital publishing as an opportunity because it gives me the chance to sell my books to you, the reader, directly. I can do away with these traders in between. Amazon's and all and Flipkart's have destroyed the book retail industry, which has got nothing to do with a publisher. Although I have a retail outlet as well, and that is suffering, my publishing is not suffering because Amazon is ultimately going to sell books made by a publisher. I can even do away with those people by selling my digital publications to you directly. So that is where the opportunity for a publisher lies, besides saving the trees.
Hello. Yeah. I was as the conversation was going on, I was struck by one thing that we live in a very uneven world. The world is uneven, and the scenario that Vaskar is talking about here, and Geeta ma'am and Preeti ma'am, they are talking about different aspects. When we ask this question, what is the choice that a reader makes? Depends on where the reader is located and what is available to the reader, what kind of access does the reader get. And I would like to know your responses to the view that what is culture to do with it? Has it to do with the family, the home where it all starts, the school, or the society or the community that one belongs to or is in? Does that play a part in making these reading choices, or that reading is important at all? Is that a question that does it come from a family? Does the family have a role? Where does it start, and how does it really draw the attention of the publisher or the publishing industry? Because after all, when Amazon makes a Kindle and wants to sell a book through Kindle, it's after all a product. And what is this relationship, or where is this bridge between the buyer as reader and the seller as publisher? And I would like your views, all of you.
Wrong person to be starting this discussion now.
Okay.
I said that I may be the wrong person to start this discussion because I may take it off in some other direction which is not a good direction. Okay. Katha works with children and with adults who come from second, third generation reading families, and children who are first generation school goers and seeing the book for the first time. I've seen children who will look at a book and just throw it, and I know children who will spend 5 minutes just touching the top of the book because it's so soft and they haven't been given a book like this. And we always treat children who cannot afford to buy their own books as if it doesn't matter. 2 rupees ke liye kuch de do inko. So we keep giving them 2 rupee books, and then we say, why are they not reading? Why are they not coming into the habit of reading? After all of us are reading. So I think this unevenness that you're talking about is very much in our lives. There are, as many people have seen, there are two Indias. And we have the India which reads in English, and we have the other India which reads in the Bhasha. I hate the word vernacular because it was given by the British, and I don't like that word vernacular. I think we read in our Bhasha, which I think is a very gentle and a more respectful way of referring to our own languages, which we own and in which many of us think. Now, when I look at how does reading come into the lives of our children, a book-rich environment, we always say, is what brings reading to children. Okay, they see their parents reading, children start reading. They see their parents going to eat, and then they go into a bookshop also, they get into the habit of, or going to a library. We don't have too many libraries, though there are 1 lakh libraries in India. The libraries are mostly non-functional. But going into a library, going into a bookshop, I think all these are ways in which we help our children to read. This is when I'm looking at this 1/3 of our country. When I look at what I think is the 2/3, and I always think that India is not the third world, it's the 2/3 world, okay? We live like Pakistan lives, and like South Asia lives, like Africa lives, like Latin America lives, and then we go aspiring for the way in which America lives. I wish we didn't do that. Even in book reading, I'm suddenly thinking that, you know, very soon the children who are going to be our leaders, who are going to get into the IAS and get into the banks and get into the all these fancy jobs, very good jobs, leadership roles, we are going to be one extension of America. We will have to change our name probably and say that we are no longer India, because they don't know what India is. They have not read our literatures. They have not read what India produces for herself. We are so happy reading what the world produces for us. We look at writers and we look down sometimes on writers who are insiders, because they only have insider knowledge. They are writing for a population which is reading in Tamil or Malayalam or Mizo or something, because they are not giving those markers which are very essential in today's world. Because if I don't live in Tamil Nadu and I don't know my Tamil landmarks, the literary landmarks and other landmarks, I remember talking to O.V. Vijayan. I do not know how many of you know O.V. Vijayan. He was this fabulous Malayalam writer, absolutely fabulous, and he wrote these fantasies which are out of this world. And he was being interviewed for an English newspaper just before I walked into his home, and he was livid. I said, Anna, what happened? Anna is elder brother. I said, Anna, what happened? And he said that, you know, this person comes here and I'm talking about Shakuntala, and she's saying, who is Shakuntala? And she said, I am not going to talk to anyone who doesn't know who Shakuntala is, or who doesn't know the Indian epics or the Indian stories. Okay. Now, today we cannot be that arrogant, I think, about, you know, the knowledge that we have, because this knowledge that we have has been in one sense appropriated by the English media. It has been appropriated by people who read and write in English. And then when we say people are not reading, we mean that population which is reading in English. I want to give you the other side of the picture. The other day I was working, we work in about 252 slums in Delhi, and we've been invited by government to work in about 500 of the government schools, the corporation schools. The other day I was working in one of these slums, and you know, I know one of these men. He's a wife beater. So we've been going and talking to him and saying, you know, maybe there's a difference that can come in his life. So whenever he sees me, he shakes his head, saying that today I'm not beating my wife. But you know, this thing of story, and I want to go to a story, which is the germane thing in book publishing. When I look at the children and the way in which children are reading today, the other day again, Katha has about more than 100 stories which are on an app and which are available for children. So we've been working with about 80,000 children today. This year, for instance, we worked with 80,000. Last year, we worked with about 80,000. Before that, with 60,000. So we are working with lots and lots of children who are our readers. they're all living in the slums of Delhi, and they are living, they are studying in government schools. They probably do not have a book written by me. But I must tell you, the other day, one of my reading mentors was telling me, Didi, do you know what happened today? I was reading a story from my mobile phone, and this woman who's a mother sitting next to me, she said, Didi, Didi, mera phone pe bhi laga do. She wants that story to be put into her phone. Now, have you ever thought of something going like this, a story or a book going like this? Now, 80,000 children are reading. How are they reading? They are reading from their mother's mobiles, their father's mobiles. It's not just these children who are in, you know, international airports playing with their father's phones and sort of doing all kinds of things. So that we see it. And I envy them sometimes. I'm sorry, but I think envy is the word. I wish that India could afford this kind of a thing for all children. And now with these 100 stories going out to children in an app, into mobile phones, from a website, to mothers, to fathers, going from them to children, I find that suddenly there is an interest in reading. Suddenly I'm finding that it is not, as we say in the English-speaking world, that children are not reading. I think children who are coming in from a very non-literate background, who've never had a book in their life, who've never thought that there was something between the covers of a book which will suddenly explode their imagination, get them to see something which they've never even imagined, and to give them that kind of an experience, and to know that that comes from a book. I think the poems, the stories, when they see this, I think it changes their world. And that is what I think many of us in my generation went through when we were looking at the book. It was such a big thing for me when, you know, once in a while I would get this 10 rupees. I remember my first 10 rupees because my foot was, you know, shaking. I was 6 or 7 or something. And it just wouldn't fall. So I had to be taken to the doctor, and I was making this big fuss about going to the doctor. So my father said, I'll get you a book. And so I went through the whole thing of having my foot removed so that I could get that book at the end of the day, a 10 rupee book. And today when I look at my children, the 80,000 children that we work with, I feel that same excitement in them. They are excited by the book. They are excited by the story. They're excited by what they are seeing. Okay. And this expansion of their world. So I want to step back and answer your question that, you know, there are two worlds. And I think that very, very invisible world that lives in our villages, that lives in our slums, that lives in poverty, somewhere we as people who speak and who are being educated in English. I'm sorry, I must be sounding very arrogant over here. Please pardon me, because that's not what I mean to be doing at all. This is the life that I mean, these are the children I know. So I think that there is that world. And if only our publishers could access that world, if we could take oral tradition stories to that world and we can enrich that world, that is our future. The future is not in this room. For me, my future is done. I mean, I'm 68 years old, and I think, you know, I'd be very happy if towards the end of my life I die on the desk without sort of, you know, doing anything other than books. But for our children, this is their future. They need to know India. They need to know our cultures. They need to know how we lead our lives. They need to know how we look at the environment. They need to know how we bring up our children. They need to know the songs that we sing to the baby in the womb. They need to know these things. And today, they are growing up, many of them, because they cannot read, or because they are not reading the kind of literatures that should be given. And I totally blame all of us sitting on this dais. Sorry, that's talking in the basket. But I think publishers, we have not done our duty. Thank you.
Of course, I completely agree with you, Geeta. We haven't done our duty at all. We've been trying, I think, at least some publishers have been maybe more committed than others, I don't know. But because of having worked where I worked, been totally and completely spoiled by that. So I know that we've always had some kind of politics and some kind of things that we believed in, which we tried to put out there. And even in many ways, therefore, the effort has been to expand what people are reading. So whether it's regions or issues or just publishing women, like what we were doing at Kali and then later at Zuban, you were always trying to create another platform and trying to sort of bring the marginalities into what is so-called mainstream publishing and writing. So I think in that way, yes, Katha has been doing it. We've been getting the best literatures from you in translation. And it's true, of course, English is being looked at as a bridge language, right or wrong. The thing is that a lot of literatures do get published, get translated across languages in this country, but English is still seen as one of those bridge languages which seems to connect the different languages. And then from my many years of experience, even at Frankfurt, for example, when you need to sell a book outside, you need to have a translation in English just to be able to give it to somebody so that they can actually read it and at least make sense of what you're trying to say to them. And later when they actually buy the book and when they do the translation, they will go to the original text. So if it's a Tamil book or a Malayalam book or whatever, they will go to the original text and do the translation from there into French or German or whatever it might be. But that initial bridge is English. And when we carry our catalogues, we do them in English because that's the way, you know, you need to operate in that world. And however much we might want to have this kind of like really perfect world where we are very committed publishers and very committed sellers of books and so on, I think the market also, it dictates what you're doing at the end of the day. So I know that when I was working with Kali and later as well, you always had a list that you know, was the wish list which you wanted to do, and then there were the others that you needed to do because there is the one which supports the other, and often those are hard decisions which publishers make. And so when I now that I'm an agent and I'm working with many of the big and small publishers in Delhi, this is what I hear increasingly. And so there may be some really large publishers who have a different kind of policy because they need to make those numbers match at the end of the day. So you need to sell that much to pay these fantastic salaries to your CEOs and whatever else is. But there are other much more small, committed kind of publishers who are only doing the books that they really believe in doing. So you've got to make some kind of balance between the two is what I think. Content is king, no doubt about that, but what kind of content do you produce? And when we talk about electronic publishing also, I think it's the content which matters. So something you want to read in a print book and keep on your bookshelf forever, you know, I mean, it's very different from what you might want to read on your phone or on your app. So I know like when Juggernaut launched, they launched with Sunny Leonie, and so it may not be something which you want to possibly keep away. So it's good for like reading when you're traveling on the metro or whatever. So it's a quick good read. And I think that's as important as the other thing, if it's bringing more people to read books and to see this as a valuable activity. Of course, it comes from homes and it comes from schools and it comes from your peer and so on. But it is something which needs constant encouragement and, you know, you need to say that, yeah, this is what is and what adds to not just knowledge, but something which is bigger than knowledge, in the sense that for me as an outsider to this region, for example, I know that when I started to travel here for the films that we were doing with Sanjoy and with the Center for Northeast Studies, that opened a whole new world as far as I was concerned. I didn't know these stories at all. And whether it's stories of conflict or whether it's stories written by writers from this side, I had not read. And apart from, I think, Indira Goswami, I had no idea about any other writer. So it's also that, you know, you need to get that translation out, and unfortunately in India it's a very difficult proposition. So now that I think most publishers are trying to put out translations as original books, so you don't call them a translation, you just put it out there in the market and people will pick it up, because just the fact of saying that this is a translation, there's a sort of a distance created between that reader and between the book, because they think that it's an intellectual activity and, you know, I'll never understand this and why should I pick it up. You have to make it as sexy and as interesting as, you know, any other thing. And so those are the sorts of problems I think that publishers are mostly faced with and the things that they have to get around. So yes, we should be publishing a certain kind of book, but often that certain kind of book piggybacks on another kind of book.
I think we have received a wide variety of answers to your question. which I'll just answer. I'll take a minute to answer as a parent, and then I'll go into the publishing blah. Regarding what is it that creates the reading habit in a child? It depends on whether how you're bringing up your child. Do you have a nanny who's spending her time by making the child watch TV, or are you putting more effort yourselves in making the child read a book and bringing him or her up in the way that you like? I think the family does matter the most, and then of course nowadays a lot of schools are putting an effort, even like what Royal Global School said today, you know, they make their children read 12 books a year. So the foundations are there, home and school, end of story. Now, speaking as a publisher, I go back to what Geeta had mentioned. What are we offering them? Yes, I blame the publishers, but then Preeti kind of protected us by saying like, no, there has to be marketability for those. If you see a very glossy, nice English children's publication with photos, and then you give them a dull black and white print of an Ohomia children's book, what is the child going to touch first? He's going to touch that colored book, the one that is more attractive, and not that Assamese book. So we cannot blame that people are not reading in Assamese, our children are not reading in Assamese, because we are not giving them something that they like. It's a child after all. You know, we can't force him to say, you know, you read Locking at Best World, don't read Hans Christian Andersen. No, we are not doing that. Number two, I'll talk because I'm as a very regional publisher who works in a very limited market. If we take out high-end books, do we have the marketability? Today, readers, the normal or people who are just buying books, I'm not talking about all sorts of readers, please don't take me wrong. They do not differentiate between books and vegetables when they are buying it from the market. They negotiate in the same bloody way. You know? So how much discount are you giving me? 50 rupees, or can you give me 30 rupees? You know, I don't sit in my retail outlet and lawyer's bookstore, because every time I sit there, my blood boils and I leave. And if I sit there too long, I'm going to lose customers. So we take out a nice book. I mean, we do not print in lakhs. Our print run is limited to thousands, 3,000, 5,000. And definitely the price of the book becomes high. So we cannot afford in SMEs all the time to, you know, take out very glossy and nice, lavish books. In the month of December, we are going to launch some books for children in the augmented reality technology. We have just collaborated with a Russian publisher called Devar Books, and these books are like, you know, a cross between digital books and traditional books. Basically, the same book you have in front of you, you can paint it, we can paint a color with it, and then you point your tab or your mobile to it, the books become 3D, the characters become live. But I'm worried. I have also got the rights to publish them in each and every Northeastern language. But I am thinking 10 times, will I be able to sell these books? Because these children's books, 16, 25, 30 pages, they'll cost about 200 rupees. And I don't think I'll be able to sell them here so much. That's why my target market is the Eastern region and the rest of India. I wish I could do them here, you know? The same children's books, you know, with the characters made out of writings by Nabokanta Borua. They point their phone to it, turns into 3D with a Nabokanta Borua poem playing behind it with music. It is going to be so attractive. But cost. I'm putting in my own money, I'm not getting a subsidy. You know? So it's like a cash 22 situation. Your children become what you offer, and you can offer what you can sell. You know? So we need to find a way out.
Yeah, it's very interesting. I was also thinking of another issue, which is not something that the readers get to see. But since I am working in Guwahati University Press, and that's the problem of stocking. When you have a print run, when you have a physical book, and titles don't get sold, so where do you stock it? And that's a huge problem, because books get wasted, and they get damaged, and you discard them. And that is a trade condition that has a long cumulative effect on the future titles, and the point Bhaskar is making, the kind of future titles that will produce. And marketability and the trade, that impacts the way the book is looked at by the publisher. Okay, this is the kind of book title I produced 5 years back. Is it going to do well now if I produce something in the similar line? And the other point, since we're looking at electronic publishing, is the ebook has been around for some time, and the laptop and the computer was the vehicle. Now it is being replaced or substituted by the mobile phone. Has not quite taken off. What could be the reason? Is it some people say, people who are accustomed to the physical book say, oh, we belong to an earlier generation, I'd like to touch on the book, I'd like to touch on the page, I'd like to keep it by the bedside. Is habit an issue here? And that the generation today is more habituated to electronically receiving or responding to content, and Kindle of course advertises as having it, saying that it's pleasing to the eye. Is that an issue? Is habit an issue with the reception of the electronic book? Or is it something to do with, again, culture, and as Bhaskar pointed out, there's something to do with the habit that comes from the home or the school? Or is it the habit to, which, because the phone is a gadget for everything else, it doesn't quite serve as a reading device, not quite. So what could be the reason for the mobile phone not taking off as the reading device? It serves for everything else. What could be the reason? Why is it not taking off? Ma'am? since you've talked about your experience in the slum situation, and how then the mother wanted to have that book in her mobile phone, and I'm talking of this in general, that where people have the mobile phone, have access to the ebook, they can download it or whatever, buy it, and yet that's not quite the way they would like to read a book.
I'm remembering, our teachers. Last year we trained about 600 teachers in our corporation schools to access information from.
You talked about the story of the go downs or whatever for the. So you were talking about that, and that of course is a problem, I think, for publishers. And again, the way publishers deal with it also is quite different. I know what we use, but we never let any get pulped or get destroyed like that, because we actually valued the book and we kept it going. We had small printers and we printed as required, but we never had to pulp them or to get them away as rabdi or some such. So which I know a lot of people do. Obviously you have to find space to keep them. So that was the first thing you said, and then about this thing about the ebook thing not having taken off. So I guess there must be a variety of reasons for that. A lot of what Geeta is saying, of course, and she's looking at a completely different market from what obviously I'm talking about. And but at the end of the day, what she's saying and what I think I'm saying as well is that it is the richness and the quality of the content that you're putting out there which is important, and which drives where you put it and in what format you put it. So whether it's a printed book, which will, I don't think, die out. Convergence. So exactly what you're saying, that a kind of way of presenting this book, maybe for younger readers and people who are now dabbling with these new technologies, it needs to be exciting for them to not just have to pick up the book and read the just the story which is there, but through that story find different things. So if every page is actually opening out into different worlds, or it's opening into a game, or it's opening into some, you know, completely other thing, that maybe you are sort of pulling in newer writers and younger writers and introducing them to this world and to this excitement. So maybe that's what it is, that you need content and you need convergence between all these technologies for them to actually work. And recently I know that there's this young neighbor in Amritsar where my married home is, and she's young. This girl has just, I think, finished her BA, but she's been writing something on Instagram and on something else where she's been doing something called Jane Mark Diaries. And of course she's got anglicized names, she would have picked up Indian names, but you know, that's because you're reading so much in English. So she's got Jane Mark Diaries where every day she goes out to some fancy spot in Amritsar and photographs herself, mostly from the back so that she's not recognized. And so then she puts out that picture and she puts out a little story with that picture. I thought I would show that to Jagannath and see what they could do with it. And it's an exciting thing because it's something which is obviously appealing to that generation. It's talking about love between Jane and Mark, and then one other third girl walking in and then what happens. But it's a daily thing which seems to engage them. It's very lighthearted, it's very fluffy, it's not something which I would pick up to read. But yes, there are so many different markets, and as we keep hearing from Mr. Modi, we have this demographic dividend. And so I guess it's a, you know, sort of appealing across the board to many demographics. So that's fine. So the other important thing here is that, is this actually expanding the market for books and for reading? So if books are doing that, or if other formats are doing that, then I think it's very worth it. So I think those were the sorts of things I wanted to mention. And then also going back to exactly the storytelling, because the story is actually the important thing in a book or in any of these ways that we find of reading. And I was reading somewhere lately that the oral storytelling tradition, which of course all our communities have had in the past and continue to have, and you know, that's something which is rich and thriving in this country, but it's something that is now beginning to catch on in places like UK and in the US, where they actually have storytelling clubs and people are sitting there and listening to stories being told. And so obviously somewhere along the line, the excessive social media or this excessive presence on all these many platforms is becoming too much for us, and we want to go back and we're harking back to that old way of face-to-face communication where you tell your story. And apparently even Salman Rushdie has been, you know, called in to tell a story. So I think we have to generally look across the board and explore all of these ways.
When we talk digital publishing, let us not forget that it is not only e-books, it is the entire digital content that is available online. And if e-books may not have taken off yet, although it's on the runway, although it may not have taken off for some reason or the other, digital publishing has taken off and it is here with us, amongst us today. Say if I'm writing an essay or a commentary, I do not have to buy a full book to find one article or a research paper that I need to refer. I can find it standalone on the web. So I'm accessing digital publication already, and I don't need that book. It is really difficult to, you know, talk about the future, but who knows, we may not have e-books as well in the future. You know, we may have digital content being published in all sorts of different formats. Something happening this morning in America, Trump giving his presidential debate lecture, or immediately, even half an hour, we get it. Imagine 30 years back, we would have to wait for the TV news in the evening, or for the Assam Tribune to come on our desks the next morning. That too without the news. So we have to look at publishing in a completely different way. And then individual, self-publishing is becoming so easy. You know, people can, you know, they do not have to invest in any inventory as such, publish it online and it's there. So we cannot really, digital publishing, as I said, is there. It is, it's really going to be crazy to think that, you know, that we will go back 100% to the way books were 20 years back. They are not like what they were before. And this transition, like, you know, that initially started with cave paintings, then with writing on rocks, and then rock edicts, then papyrus, then hardbounds, then paperbacks which were a taboo at one point of time when they were started by Penguin Books. And now paperbacks are a norm. So even that is going to vanish. No, not totally vanish, of course. Sorry. But the moment the demand for printed books goes down, a lot of printers will also be rethinking their business. Printing machines will evolve, or maybe a lot of them will go out of existence. And then books will be there. It's not like it is going to vanish, you know. But it's going to be limited. You know, it's going to be something that you like to flaunt, you like to keep in the shelf. But you'll have to have a great library, but you don't have space. You know? So where do you keep your books? I keep it on my tab. You know? So regarding e-books not taking off or taking off again, see, looking at the penetration of smartphones and internet today, but its usage, you know, still e-books or digital publishing is a pretty much urban phenomenon. Although phones and internet are there in every nook and corner of India, but what are they being used for? You know, so that usage, ultimately people will get fed up of Facebook, they'll get fed up of WhatsApp, nothing remains, you know. And then hopefully these people will also start reading serious materials, you know, on their phones and off the web. So I think we are there. It's a transition phase, and it may not happen in our lifetimes, it may take a generation or two generations for the whole thing to change, but times they are changing.
It's interesting. The point you're making is interesting, because you were primarily talking of the reading and the writing that goes on in the web or in the platform. But I was actually looking at the question of publishing. So the point it was making about this young writer publishing her diaries. It's a self-publishing mode, and so is that impacting the reading of a book, whether it's in a digital form, reading a web page, or reading a digital content, or having an encounter or interaction with digital content, maybe visual, maybe auditory, maybe verbal. That is a slightly different thing than when we're looking at publishing.
A book is a printed book. That is there. You know, that you cannot deny. As a whole, overall content thing, whatever I said, that is different. But today, I mean, if you come to me and I tell you I'm going to publish an e-book, you're not going to be with me. You know, and even the a lot of, like, you know, conventional publishers, the discussion Preeti and I were shortly having before this, a lot of big names, conventional publishers, are going to vanity publishing today,
right,
under different names. You know? And they offer packages, like, you know, well, you'll be astounded. I mean, what's the name of this publisher who are pretty famous? They've become, you know, the self-publishing. Partridge. You won't find a mention of Penguin, I think, anywhere in the website, right? So it's a package, you know, you want 10 books, 20 books, 40 books. Okay, then they'll give you 10 books for, like, you know, printed copies they'll give you. Rest will be published as an e-book. You're paying for it. So you can see where we are going, you know, where we are at the moment. I know, I mean, they'll have a different perspective, no?
No, in vanity publishing, the writer is actually interested in the production of the book and in the name, rather than it getting a market. And that's the hope that the writer...
Vanity publishing, sir, today is almost replacing mainstream publishing. Because as I said, the book marketability has changed. You know, a lot of terrible quality. A writer, when he writes a book, he thinks he's going to be the next Upamanyu Chatterjee. He's not here. But no, I mean, the writer has to write the book and think, like, you know, is this good or is this rubbish? You know, that judgment very few writers make. And the ones who make that judgment, he becomes an established and good writer. The one who can't make that judgment is trash.
But what about, you know, this entire pre-press process that the editorial policy, you select a book, you select a manuscript?
That's
send it for review.
Yes, see, that's what I was going to say. like because of the lack of products or the changes in the market, the returns are not as big as they used to be. A lot of publishers are going into vanity publishing where they are not really screening those books in detail. And the books are yet being published. So
how does the reader get to know?
How does the reader get to know? You have to ask
the audience.
Yeah.
We'd also like to
Yeah. So we'd like to hear response.
I'd like to say a word in defense of vanity publishing also. The history of Indian poetry in English is the history of vanity publishing. From Nisim Ezekiel to Adil Jassawala to Eunice D'Souza to Arvind Krishna Menon. Every big name in Indian poetry in English was published by himself or herself, because Indian poets were always let down by publishers. Publishers never want to produce an original book of poems, but as soon as the poet has put together the book and it has come out, they will rush to do anthologies. And when they do anthologies, they have not the courtesy to pay for those poems, they have not the courtesy to offer royalties, and they simply act as parasites. This is mainstream publishing upon the poet's work and effort. So while we can diss and we can offer endless disrespect to vanity publishing, remember that it is because very often a publisher will not want to take risks. A publisher will not want to invest in what he or she sees as not being financially viable, that forces people, including Henry Miller abroad, including Anais Nin abroad, including James Joyce abroad, to do their publishing on their own. So if you look at history, you'll see that there's a very different attitude that is being taken from this side of the fence. My own first book of poems, after being rejected by 17 publishers, was published by me on my own, with my own money. Vanity Press, you can call it. I say it was my decision that my poetry would go out into the world, and now it has been anthologized in 18 different places. Not one publisher has ever paid me. Disgusting and disrespectful to the original poets. That's what I call it.
I can't agree with you more, sir.
But and how many books of poetry do you do?
Very less. Because they don't sell. And that's
what I'm saying. So don't ever talk about vanity publishing as though it's some kind of stepchild of the industry.
No, I think you missed out what I said originally.
You said
no. Digital publishing is providing more opportunities for vanity publishing, isn't it?
I do not believe that there should be a term called vanity publishing. Start with,
the term is there. I can't just erase it.
No. If you take the word vanity. Vanity comes from vanitas. Vanitas comes from the Latin root of one of the seven deadly sins. Already, if you want to say vanity publishing, you are already putting a negative label on that person. If you want to do that, by all means, feel free. Be insulting. Insult Adil Jassawala. Insult Nisim Ezekiel. Insult Giv Patel. Insult Eunice D'Souza. Insult all the poets who have done it. Mere ko kya. You can always say, I have done less because they do not sell. This is a lie. Poetry books always sell. There is never, on the streets of Bombay, where every single novel will come out again and again, there is never a book of Indian poetry in English. Why? Because people buy them and keep them forever. And they don't sell them again. They never go out of the house. Poetry becomes part of you. But the publisher has to say, I will stand by you for 5 years. Because poems are shared. Poetry is a conspiracy. Together, all of us become the poem. And we become the poem when we take the time to buy that poem over years. My Asylum and Other Poems is not available anymore. Why is it not available anymore? I published it myself, I put my 10,000 rupees down, 500 copies were done, 500 copies sold out. But because I held them at home, I put in the demurrage, I put in the go down space, and eventually I sold all the books. They don't not sell. That's another dirty, pernicious lie that publishers make. They sell, but they sell slowly, and if you are not willing to put that time into publishing, then don't be a publisher.
Well, but then, sir, with all due respects to you, and you're a great poet, all due respects to you, you know, you can invest in your own book, you can take it out, but as a publisher, we do not have to deal with only one author. We have got 10 different people who have aspirations from us. And of course, we'll be going with the one where we can roll that investment in. We are not being paid by Digital India, or we are not being paid by the government. We have to make our money roll so we can meet the aspirations, not just of you, but of other writers as well, whose books are selling. So we have to be fair, because we have to pay our employees, we have to pay our overheads. Things are not coming free, sir. And that's why you are investing in one book of yours, you're welcome to do it.
I'd also like to inflict you on another thing. Publishing salaries and will routinely pay to the average intern. Publishers will routinely pay the average intern more than they will give an advance to someone who has spent 5 years on a book. Averagely. When you say content is king, I laugh. Because marketing is king. What you pay your marketing head is almost routinely an insult to every single published book you publish. Everyone knows this. We walk into your offices on foot from the metro, and your marketing head has sworn in an air-conditioned car, which I have subsidized. I have subsidized his salary with my content. Content is not king. Content is chaprasi.
I don't know. I'm very sorry. I mean, the relationship, the kind of publishers you met, whose offices you walked into and saw this, but I think it would be unfair to generalize.
No, I mean, there are just three, four things. When you said this first thing about vanity publishing, So when you talk about vanity publishing, I think forget the term, but what you can't hear.
Can you say self-published?
Yeah, self-published. Is this better? So it may be the term, it's just generally obviously derogatory to refer to it as vanity publishing, no doubt about it, but some of it is vanity publishing. It's crap, okay, but it's vanity. And you're just doing it to massage your own ego, and that's the end of it. Nobody's ever going to buy that book. So forget that. What we are actually referring to here is like a service which you're offering to authors across the board. It may be a good author, bad author, indifferent, whatever. But this is a service, and this is what Partridge does, and I know that many others are doing it. It's you have the money to pay for something, and the publisher needs that money for XYZ reasons. So it's a service. So that's the end of whatever we were talking about when we said about vanity publishing. The other thing about content is king. Well, I mean, obviously people differ. Publishers' opinions also differ. And if Penguin doesn't think content is king, I'm sorry, I do think content is king. So my list will never become that. I will never make money. Whatever advances I can earn from my authors, and I will get 15% of that, will be some fiddling 5,000. Theek hai. But I know that at the end of the day, the book that I put out is a book you want to read, is a book you would treasure, a book you might want to pass on to your child if you brought them up the right way. Yeah, sure. So I think as many people and readers, that many publishers, and the kind of the philosophy or whatever you want to call it, or the commerce that you have at the end of the day, and somewhere you have to make the whole thing balance. So that's how it is. Small publishers, like where I was working, and I said earlier that I'm sort of fortunate, and I think I was very spoiled because I did the books that I wanted to do. I mean, as opposed to books that you are forced into doing. And I know that the one or two times when we try to do that kind of book, like, you know, hold up Chetan Bhagat, try to do a book which has got a cover with this fancy, you know, beautiful red heel on it, and it says something about, I can't even remember the name of the book, but it was something to do with women who work in BPOs. And we thought we'd have our next female, you know, whatever, bestseller thing. But no, we couldn't, because we couldn't crack the market. We don't know that market. So you obviously work to a certain market that you know. And if at Kali and at Zuban, I know my market, probably Penguin Random and whoever else knows their market. So they work to obviously put out stuff that, and the writers who go to them also mostly are the ones who, you know, you also know where you want to go, who you want to publish with. So as an agent, I'd say in the present, I am happiest, say, with the list that Speaking Tiger is doing right now, as opposed to much bigger publishers. But then that's what makes me happy. It may not necessarily make you happy. So.
Yeah,
I just want to say, I think from many, many years, we've had writers publishing themselves. Many people have published themselves. We never called it vanity publishing. This is a name given by big publishers to what they are doing with writers. So I do not think we should mistake what Adil Jasawala and Eunice D'Souza and all did with the kind of vanity publishing which is happening. I think they are two very different genres.
Yeah, different genres. That's a good way of putting it, actually.
Actually, I can be heard. There are three things. One is, I'd really like to know from the two publishers who are here, how much of a future do you see in electronic publishing as far as you're concerned? I mean, how much of this are you investing in? What do you see that as something to go for? How much percentage of this is going to be your take, because that's the theme in the next, say, let's say by 2020. How much was, that's one thing. The second thing is, far as book lists which don't sell, stocks that, you know, I've just changed jobs. I'm in something called the Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative. In our office, we have thousands of little books lying around, and I just sent off a message to our team saying that why didn't you send them to libraries? Why don't you send them to schools? Why didn't you send them to universities and colleges? Now, isn't that, if you're not making money on that and it's taking up space, even if you want to spend, save space by creating a digital space, go down, what is there can be easily distributed for free, and many people are hungry for this. And the third thing is, there is a demographic dividend, what you referred to. There may be a demographic dividend, but there is a digital divide. As far as rural India is concerned and urban India is concerned, even in urban areas of India, there are huge pockets where access to the net, because how do you connect? You connect largely through this. That's your tool. All your apps are in here, or some may be in your laptop or desktop. So as long as that gap remains and connectivity is not as extensive as it could be, maybe it will be in the future, you will continue to have a gap in the reading capacities, and you know, that whole, the publishing area will continue to be limited to niche urban and semi-urban societies. A last thing was said this morning about people from the Northeast not getting access to space in the literary world. I don't think that's correct. I think people like Janice Parriott is being reviewed across the world. Aruni Kashyap, a large number of people are being respected and published and doing well. You know, I think Aruna, Padanga, Kolita, many others, Mitra themselves. So I think that is something we do need to understand and accept.
So I'll take the e-publishing future in terms of our Assamese language. You would want to know that as well, I think. Technically, we are facing certain issues at the moment with the fonts and everything to turn them into EPUBs. You know, a lot of the SMEs fonts that we can use in book publishing, not for regular typing, not for Unicode and all that. We are facing, I mean, as far as my experience is concerned, we are facing certain issues, and that is the first hurdle that we have to cross. I won't be able to give you figures in terms of how much, you know, percentages and all the market share would be in the future. That we have to wait and see. As I said, we are still in the transitional stage. In terms of stock, that is termed debt. What we do basically, you know, after a certain, we do end up with a lot of dead stock, like a lot of publishers. We do end up donating them a lot to, like, you know, new libraries, poor students, you know, whoever wants them, donations. And even if we can't exhaust them, even after donating, then we sell them as ready. I mean, we have to clear space, you know. And regarding the rural and the urban thing, yes, right now it is the e-reading or e-books is a very urban phenomenon, rural, but the hope is that because of the penetration of smartphones and internet, so there also it will translate into, like, you know, the demographic dividends in the future. So that's the kind of a phase we are in a sense. But as far as English language is concerned, e-books are, of course, in a much different ballgame, and Geeta would be perfect person to answer that.
As far as Katha is concerned, we are going more and more e. So I think we could say that probably 50-60% of our books would be e, because we want to get in a lot of translation. We want to be producing a lot of books for children and for young adults. We want to bring the richness, and we cannot do it as books. We don't have the money to do it as books. So we are looking at e. E also works because a lot of governments, like the UP government, the Tamil Nadu government, have given computers to their children and their students, but they do not have any content over there. We are hoping that, you know, maybe if we can put some good content over there, maybe there would be some kind of reading that happens. To the books that we have, yes, I think we are giving it away to students. We are putting it out at 10 rupees to students who would like to buy the books. We are sending it to libraries. We don't pulp also. So we've never pulped a single book in Katha. But they are being given away. So it's more readers rather than more money, I think. We are not looking at money over here. And the third, the digital divide. Yes, there is a huge digital divide. But if you look at, for instance, we were recently in Rajasthan, in the villages of Rajasthan. And government is trying very hard to set up these centers where children can come, people can come and read. I think the future is where government participation has to be there. They are laying their, you know, their fiber optics lines and things like that. This we've been hearing for the last few years now. And if it comes, I think then it should take off in a very big way.
I think you asked the publishers.
Yeah. I'm a bit the old-fashioned that way. I prefer the hard copies because I want to feel it and I want to feel of books better. But since so many people prefer e-book, then one more problem I have seen is piracy. How do you face this problem? Because once a copy of e-book is downloaded by someone, then he can distribute it. So that will be piracy will be easier in this case. How do we face it?
I think this is like, you know, when you had Kabir singing and you had, you know, Tukaram and interactive storytelling. We never thought about copyright, so we never thought about piracy. I think we are coming full circle. We are coming to a point when stories will be available. They will be taken up like music. I mean, music is now in the public domain. And I know that writers may not like it, publishers may not like it, because I think once the book is out there, it is out there. I mean, now, for instance, Google has a lot of these books that is out there. Yeah, you cannot read the whole book, but you read quite a few pages of that book. And many of us then maybe don't go and read the whole book. Research, for instance, like you were saying, I put in my keyword and then I go and read that all those relevant portions in the Google. And I don't have to buy that book at all. So I think, you know, this the time when we had writers making money out of their books, maybe that period when the e-books come into play, maybe that's going to go. I don't know. I really don't know.
No, you are scaring us off. Different, we cannot reach it. No? Just one thing, technically in ebooks there is something called DRM, Digital Rights Management, which prevents you from a multiple number of copies being downloaded. You know, you can dictate how many copies can be downloaded. Like in Kindle, I think 2 or 3, you know, accordingly, you know, that you can do. And digital, good, strong DRM, in fact, might help in solving the problem of piracy than printed books. Printed books are pirated like anything. You know, previously people would just take a photograph in the days of those films, you know, and then print it. You know, Harry Potter, you know, all those Delhi streets, the Patri Wala, crazy.
Why? You know,
that way it was a benchmark, it was a meter, yeah, I don't know how. And even now, piracy is such a major headache. Again, like, you know, what we publishers, again, invest in, and a lot of that is a reason why a lot of our books don't end up selling, because of piracy. And that is why we cannot often invest in books that are good, but may sell slow. I hope you understand what I mean. So, but anyway, so that's the answer for DRM. If we,
are you actually proposing a future in which you will not be having a business out of book publication? It will be more of a social charitable cause, because if you have to counter this concept of copyright, as my friend Vijay was telling out here, then the only way out is that there should be no money involved. Like, whatever you do, there's no money involved.
It's called the business of books, no? So,
I mean, that's it's the journal. It's a common problem.
No, no, I've been saying that it's basically a balance between the kind of content that you want to put out, and I said, like, you know, basically that you're also piggybacking your good stuff on your not so good stuff. I think mostly that's what you try and do. So if it's called the business of books, then there obviously has to be a business, and no author is going to come to you if you're not, you know, paying them something. I mean, yeah, I agree you don't make a great deal of money out of your writing, but you are expecting to be recognized, and one of the recognitions, apart from reviews and being called to literary festivals, is to get that check. You know, that's also recognition. So how can you just get away from it?
Points for me also.
I think it's, I'm sorry to be saying this, but it is readers or money. I think most of us as writers want readers. We want to be read. We want somebody to come into on our books. We want even that one letter coming saying, you know, I read your book and I liked it, or I like this character, your protagonist. I'm feeling top of the world, and I can live on that for quite a long time. The second thing is, when I look at readers, India is such a country that we cannot have readers who can pay the money for this. If you are looking at payment for everything, so the other day we had this illustrator who had come from Latin America, and she was with us, and we had our own illustrators who said that, you know, we need to be paid for what we are doing. And she said, I get paid by the advertising agencies and I get paid by people who can pay for it, but I would like to be giving it to people who can reach out and get my readers. Zanussi, the filmmaker who had come into one of the Katha Utsavs, he said, I love to see my books on the payment pirated, my films. Because he said, I've made my money out of my films, I've shown them, I've made my money, now I want people to see. So I think there is a need, there's a hunger in writers to be read, to be appreciated, to be enjoyed. And that against the money, I think, I don't know, I don't have all the answers, but they are two sides of a picture. Sorry.
You know, it appears that through this conversation, it appears that we do have a bright side from the publishing industry, but we also have things that we are probably unhappy about, and we can see it coming from everywhere.
I was trying to sort of, you know, look at what you mentioned, Geeta Dharmarajan, about the Bhasha literatures that you, popularizes. And going from that, I think from the northeast of India, and particularly in Assam,
what is very interesting is that despite this huge
this huge kind of, you know, swamping by the electronic press and the electronic publishing houses. What is also being witnessed, is the staggering amount of Bhasha literature that comes out from this region. If you go to any bookshop, as perhaps Bhaskar said, you would find that every bookseller is a publisher, and there are loads and loads of books that are waiting to be read. My question here is therefore, you know, not going by the Nielsen's survey, but as practicing publishers, somebody who does academic publishing, like Vibhash, trading, Bhaskar, and NGO, you also, all of you, which do you think is the segment that actually now reads, you know, books that are in print, that are being published most? Which is the segment? And I don't suspect it is the young. That's one. And related to it is the other question, and that is the other fear that we have in academic publishing, is a number of books that also pour in because of the need for an ISBN mark to any kind of publication that you wish to be seen, you know, as being part of. So how does one check this ISBN syndrome? Is there a control mechanism by which all kinds of books that come out, in which all kinds of writers get published, can actually be checked?
The academic publishing bit, I think, following what the UGC has done, and there's a professional need for academics to publish. The ISBN is given by the Ministry of Human Resource to anyone who applies. So if I want to get a book published, I have to apply to the Ministry of Human Resource and give a justification that this is the kind of program I have, and they'll send the number of ISBNs. And I put the ISBN on any book that I want to get printed. So it's free for all.
The more the merrier.
Yeah, no one cares. So getting ISBN on a book is easy. It's nothing.
This is a very dangerous thing UGC is doing. Make a point.
Start with ISBN, ISSN, and then you find this is not working, then you go to peer review, then you know, right? Sometimes it will not work, and you find out something.
Yeah, so academic publishing is it's piracy for all, free for all. Anyone can do it. The point about quality is where I think academics have erred themselves. Academics want shortcuts. So, there is favoritism, there is preferential choices, and then, okay, I want this book published, and give me a review and all that. So, I don't know. In academic publishing, of course, there are outstanding books being published. And visibility is a problem. Academic publishings are, publications are very highly priced. The publishers price them very high, sell it to libraries. And my fear is that there are two kinds of academic publishing. There's a popular kind of academic publishing, and goes back to Rakhimaya's question about who reads, who is the potential reader. I think the potential reader or the recognized reader is the reader of textbooks. The school child or the college going student who buys because there's no way out. Whether the book is on the table and whether it's read or not is a different thing. But then those are the books that are bought. And most publishers publish textbooks. So that is an avenue that actually gets the money. You have, as Bhaskar knows and we all know, that you have CBSE textbooks not published by NCERT, on which are doing parallel business. So that's getting money. So academic publishing is something that pretty started with that. There is no quality control, and it's, as Bhaskar, it's a messy industry. I don't know how that is going to be controlled and how things are going to work out. Self-regulation is a way. So it applies to everyone, to writers and to publishers. And very, very strict editing policies. That one problem with the industry in Assam is that publishers don't have strong editorial policies and reasons for rejection. It becomes very emotional when a publisher, I think Bhaskar has faced that, when you have to tell a writer, a potential writer, I'm not going to publish a book, and then reasons are not given. Sound reasons, editorial reasons are often not given. Rakhivari's question was to all of us, I think, but then we are running short of time. So it's we're supposed to close at 1:45. So you're all almost there. Any short comments from anyone?
Published work, and when it comes to self-publishing, and anybody and everybody can be a writer, then how is a royalty divided, or what is the royalty part that the author earns?
But I would like to answer your question about the segment. I think it's the children's segment across the world which is growing very, very big. The children's segment is the one, 25% more than the general segment, is the growth that has been shown by the children's publishing. I think in India what's happening is two things. One, it has been taken up by the four big publishers. Like in accounts, we have the four big accounting firms, we have these four big publishers, and they've taken over that space. So small, fiercely independent publishers like us do not really share that piece of the pie, so we don't come into that. And the second thing is, I think the kind of readers we have. India has about 400 million children, that's 4,000 lakh children, in the 0 to 15, 16 age group. It's a huge population of children who are waiting to read. But as publishers, we are not giving it to them, and they are just coming into it. Most of them are living in poverty, 60% of them living in poverty. They cannot buy books. So the challenge for us is, can we as adults, as publishers, as people who are interested, take up that challenge and provide for the readers, rather than looking at royalty, looking at, because this amount of money that comes into our hand is always very small. There is what is reported in media about these royalties going to people is all, I think it's a myth. It's fiction. Most writers are not getting that kind of money. Most writers are getting very small amounts of money. So we have to see what is it that we want and take a call from there. Maybe, I'm sorry, that's not the right answer, but that's the only answer I have.
Yeah, I'd like to respond to Bhaskar's question about royalty regarding ebook.
Pricing of an ebook.
Pricing of an ebook is done by the publisher depending on the some factors. In academic publishing, for instance, the ebook is priced on the potential download that is anticipated, the number. And it is, of course, the cost is lower than the printed book. And it is priced depending on the market that is that the published target market that the publisher looks at. So if it's an academic book which is supposedly going to be bought by academics, then it's priced accordingly. But it's definitely priced depending on the target readership. I think we have come to the time for closing this, and I'm really grateful to everyone, especially the panelists, for their remarks, for the comments, for the views, and of course sharing their own situations and stories in order to respond to this theme for which we have all gathered here. And I really thank the audience for sitting through all this and responding and reacting and giving their views. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of this panel discussion, that is traditional publishing versus electronic publishing.